domestically within a market, this population, realize that the population of people in this market is much bigger than the ones who have moved abroad to work or who have family who have moved abroad to work. And they're facing the same problem.
Hello and welcome to Coffee and Conversation on BTCN. I'm your host, Shashank Bengali, and I'm here with Paul Mainz-Austin. He's the Chief Product Officer for DT1. Paul, thanks for being with us.
Yeah, glad to be here.
So tell us a bit about DT1. How did you guys get started? What's the population you're trying to serve with your company?
Right, so DT1 is what we call like a global API platform. And it started here in Singapore in the late 2000s with a pretty simple idea that as sort of the developing economies were developing, a big part of the workforce were leaving their home country to work abroad. A lot of corridors you might think of might be India to the Gulf region, or Myanmar to Thailand, or Indonesia to Malaysia. And a core concern for you at that point as a person working outside of your home is, how do you send value? You've gone outside of your country to earn. How do you send value back to your home? And traditionally that was done through, let's say, offline agent-based models where you send cash or otherwise engage with a network of agents. And the problem there is that there's high risk and low trust in those. But then the bank alternatives or your Western Unions were expensive. You have your Forex costs that were often adding a significant margin on the transaction. And for someone who's earning or sending back, you know, in the order of $1 or a few dollars, less than 20, this is the margins make it extremely unattractive. For this population, the mobile phone was the way for them to stay connected as they move abroad, and also for them to engage in business back home. And so DG1 had the idea that if we could integrate with the telco in the home country and then provide a channel in the country where the workers are working, and they could provide an interface for those migrant workers where they could use their prepaid mobile wallet and send some of that value back, and it would be delivered directly to their family or their friend's phone. And they would know that the transaction had gone through. And even though it's a pretty simple idea for a target population where they don't have a lot of money to pay, in 2018, 2019, for example, in Indonesia, we sent 28 million transactions to over 12 million recipients in Indonesia.
So what's the average dollar value for one of these transactions?
So it totally depends on the market corridor we're talking about. In a lot of countries in Africa, we might be talking about 20, 50, 80 cents. In Indonesia, it might be $1 to $3. In Latin America, it can get up to $10 or $20 that people are sending.
And are these people, they're not really unbanked, so to speak, because they probably have access to banks, or are they totally out of the financial system in that respect?
In Africa, mobile money itself has become a kind of currency. You can actually cash out of your wallet. And so in those cases, whether you have access to a bank or not, is in some ways the mobile wallet plays some of that function. In other places, in Latin America or in India, for example, you've got a really wide distribution of, and deep penetration in state and public banks. And so most of this population will have access to a bank account.
Then what you're providing in a way is an end run around banks for these small transactions, because they don't really make sense for either the consumer or for the bank to handle these small amounts. So is it kind of a way to get around the typical financial system and just work in mobile money?
So on the one hand, this might actually be a substantial part of their remittance. They may actually be making that much. And there we might be talking about an inter-Africa corridor, let's say between South Africa and Zimbabwe. But if they sent that money through a bank, then yes, the margin, the cut, it just wouldn't be worth it for the bank. And that's why they charge such high fees. This target, the recipients, don't have laptops. They don't have computers. Their primary way of communicating with their family abroad is through the phone. But most of this population is a prepaid market. Another thing we found is that to a certain extent, for you and I, the thing that money does is it's fungible, and that's its value. It's sort of, I can give you money and you can use it for however you want. But for some of this population, having a degree of control in terms of what that money is spent on is itself a small value proposition. I might be a woman who's left Indonesia to work in Singapore, and because I'm away, I don't get to have the same control over family decisions that I would be if I was at home. And so this way, if I send money, it might be spent on anything. In some cases, unfortunately, on things that she might not approve of. For Indonesia, we're also integrated with other forms of value, like electricity payments. In some cases, you can actually pay your electricity through your prepaid wallet in Malaysia or Singapore.
What other benefits have you seen in terms of unlocking the economic potential for this group, this community?
Domestically within a market, this population, we realize that the population of people in this market is much bigger than the ones who have moved abroad to work or who have family who have moved abroad to work. And they're facing the same problem. They might be working an odd job. They're not being paid regularly necessarily the way you and I, again, would be. And so they may reach at some point in the middle of the month and not have enough, and they've run out of credit, again, with their prepaid wallet. So DT1 enables what's called airtime credit, where they can use it, let's say a USSD menu or send an SMS, and based on their phone history, they can get access to a small airtime loan. That means is we'll top their phone up, and then the next time they top their phone up with cash or however else they're paying, we'll deduct it from their wallet. And the interesting idea here is that in a way you're building a line of credit through a non-monetary, an airtime or data value. But that can be used down the road for actual loans, small loans or other forms of financial services.
So in terms of technology as we go forward, what advances do you see in tech and AI that could further enhance what these services can do for people?
Yeah. So one is the thing around identity that I mentioned, and really asking how can you take a person's phone history and let's say there are CDRs, which are call detail records that a telco collects based on your traffic or your behavior on the phone, and build an identity around that we can use and maybe create API endpoints that another customer, let's say a merchant, can use to sort of verify who you are, that you've been in this space, that you've been paying your mobile bill. That is actually one of the biggest predictors of fraud for a lot of digital transactions, is just, are you connected to a phone that's been actively paying for more than 3 months? The other one that we're working on at DT1 is really the question of, as this population gets wealthier, and as they come online and they're able to engage with their phones, as this population grows, I think more and more of the world in terms of international companies, Amazons, your Facebooks, and Googles, want to engage with them. But what we realized is that because of the lack of identity or because of the historical poverty that they've been within, it's hard for people to understand how to engage with this market. And so what we've realized is that, for instance, SMS is a great way to communicate with this population because it's low cost in terms of data, and it's directly how it's the mode of communication that they use. The key thing is, with all that variety, we're talking about hundreds of millions, the next billion population across 160 countries. The key, I think, for that is experimentation, is sort of being able to say, we don't know the right way to speak with you, so instead we're going to we can't necessarily speak with you as an individual, but we can segment you into kinds of identities where some kind of good or service might be more relevant to you. And then ask ourselves, how can we construct different types of messages? And in science speak, we think of that as a treatment, and send that in parallel and look at our conversions in terms of the response. And kind of enabling that degree of care and attention and development in terms of your communication, I think is a really cool thing that technology can enable. And most of our customers don't necessarily have the technology to enable them to do that. But if we're able to build that platform, they're able to do that through our system. So now we're not just offering infrastructure to actually deliver the top-up. We're also offering the infrastructure and the system to allow you to communicate with that population effectively.
Well, I think we'll stop there. That's all the time we have. Thanks very much, Paul. Thanks for joining us here on Coffee and Conversation on BTCN. I'm Shashank Bengali, and we'll see you next time.